What I'd like to do today is to present our recent work on data-enabled design for combustion dynamics in propulsion systems. Combustion dynamics means unsteady motions in a propulsion system. Essentially, we are talking about large amplitude pressure oscillations. Can we have the light off? Yes. Let me give you a little bit of background. Human space exploration commenced in 1957 when Russia, or former Soviet Union, put their first spacecraft into low Earth orbit. In the past 6 years, tremendous progress has been made. For example, in 1965, the first Mars flyby mission was conducted by NASA JPL. And in 1969, we were able to send a human to the moon and return them safely back to the Earth. That's the famous Apollo project. And in 1981, we started with our space shuttle program. And that's the first one. Then in the following 30 years, we were able to send 135 space shuttle missions to space. And the shuttle program ended in 2011. And most recently, we are most familiar with accomplishment for our exploration on the Mars, so-called Curiosity program. So this is a tremendous progress made in the past 60 years in terms of space transportation and space exploration. But then what about the propulsion system? The situation is not as good as our space program. Yes, in the past 65 years, in the US, essentially, we developed only 32 primary rocket engines and their derivatives. Only 32 primary engines and their derivatives. Essentially, in the past 60 years, we can consider four different time periods. For example, in the space race and the Russian ICBM time period, this is the prime time for the US space propulsion. We produced 13 major rocket engines during that time. Then in the Apollo program, we essentially developed six main engines, including the famous F1 and also famous J2 engines, combined with several in-space engines, such as Lunar Module Descent and Lunar Module Ascent engines. And in the space shuttle time period, we developed three major rocket engines. The most famous one is the space shuttle main engine, orbital maneuver engine, and the reaction control engines, combined with the famous mighty solid rocket boosters. So this is the prime time for US space propulsion development. But after that, almost 40 years, essentially, there was no primary rocket engine developed, almost 40 years' time. Until the situation became a little bit different in early 2000. At that time, Rocketdyne established their RS-60 engine. Essentially, this is an enlarged scale of a J2 engine developed in the 1960s. So this is the situation. It was not very exciting at that time. Most recently, because of commercialization, several companies developed their rocket engines. This includes SpaceX's Raptor engine, Aerojet Rocketdyne's AR-1, and also Blue Origin's BE-4 engines. So this is the most developed, most recent development. Well, this one shows the rocket engine development in the US, okay, in the past almost 70 years, from 1945 all the way to 2012. On the left, we have the situation for solid rockets. On the left, we have liquid rockets. There are several messages that I'd like to convey to you. If you look at those two charts more carefully, you notice that number one is most rocket engine development programs in the US are short-lived. So in other words, folks establish those programs and then they cancel those programs in 2 or 3 years for whatever reasons. This is number one. And the number two is for flight engines, the development time is anywhere between 5 to 10 years. So this is a very time and resource consuming effort. And the number three is, as I already mentioned, the situation in the past 40 years was very depressing. Essentially, okay, there's only one engine developed in the US, which is RS-68, by Rakhidan at that time. So this is one. Let's go back to the history a little bit. This one shows the Saturn V launch vehicle used in the Apollo project. For the first stage, okay, we have five famous F1 engine. Each engine produced 1.5 million thrust force. So combined, the liftoff thrust is 7.5 million, and that's equivalent to 30 Boeing 747 thrust. And stage two, we have a J2 engine. Each one produced a 250,000 pound thrust. There are five J2 engines on second stage. On third stage, we have just one J2 rocket engine, then combined with upper stage engines. So this is the Saturn V launch vehicle. So in summary, for the Apollo project, the nation developed six different engines, F1, J2, and including this reaction control engines, with a thrust ranging from 100 pounds all the way to 1.5 million pound thrust force. This is the situation in that time. Well, of course, because of the accomplishment in space propulsion, we are able to send a human to the moon and return them safely. There are 12 people working on the moon. So that's what we accomplished almost 50 years ago. And the next year, we have a huge celebration of the 50th anniversary of the Apollo project. This is what we have. One very important question is how much money we spend on developing those rocket engines. Frankly speaking, nobody knows how much money that we spend on those rocket engines. But we did a very careful analysis. We found for F1 engine, the nation spent $2.4 billion, but that's in 1966 money. And it translates to $17.85 billion in today's money. That's for F1 engine. For J2 engine, this is upper stage oxygen, hydrogen engine, the nation spent $1.7 billion in 1966. That is equivalent to almost $13 billion in today's money. Can we afford that? The answer, naturally, no. It's not affordable, even in today's environment. For comparison, well, how much money needed for us to develop an aircraft engine nowadays? Well, for aircraft engine, the rule of thumb is we have to put in $2 billion cash up front. And with the expectation that the company would not receive any money back in the first 7 to 10 years. But after the 7 to 10 years, if the engine sells well, then that engine will become cash cow. And that's the situation in the US, which is almost true for other nations as well. Yes, so that's why. Now, that's the first thing, how much money we spend. The second thing is, okay, how we develop those engines, say back in 1960s. So as an engineer, especially for aerospace engineers, we are always concerned with two things, how much money we are going to spend and how we develop our product. On the design side, okay, you probably have seen this many times. This is JFK's famous speech in front of Congress in 1961. So basically he said, well, within one decade, we want to send a human onto the moon and return them safely within one decade. Well, of course, that's a very, very ambitious goal at that time. Well, then that's for the entire program. So the president essentially gave people 10 years time, although we accomplished that within 7 years. That's remarkable. How much time for rocket propulsion system development? Essentially, they were given only 3 years time, because 10 years, that's for the entire program. For propulsion system, they were only given 3 years time. Well, it's not so easy at that time. So what they did is, okay, they basically scale up the H1 engine. This engine were already developed at that time. So they scale up from H1 to F1. F1 use liquid oxygen and kerosene as propellants. If we put our handsome professor Kim Martin here, Kim, you must be very humbled in front of F1. Yes, that's the situation. Yes. Well, so so they develop a test engine, put that on a test stand. Unfortunately, they encounter all kinds of technology problems. One of the most serious technology problems is combustion stabilities. Some people call that combustion dynamics. Some people refer that to undesired high amplitude of pressure solutions. I just want to highlight some point. Yes, this is the measured chamber pressure. Please focus to the scale. Each grid represents 5,000 psi, and that the average chamber pressure is only 1,000 psi. But they experienced a peak-to-peak pressure oscillation on the order of 10,000 psi. So what's the consequence? Well, the consequence, of course, is everything burned out within a few seconds. Keep in mind, okay, this is a test rocket engine. And if you consider the injector faceplate, it's made of a stainless steel. It's about a 10-inch thickness. But even for such a heavy metal piece, it burned out in a few seconds. So this pretty much tells us the kind of problems people encounter at that time. So how to cure this problem? They got only 3 years' time. They got no choice. So they practically tried every possible injector pattern that the people could come up with at that time. Then they tried that. And this is a short summary of the injector patterns they considered, combined with a number of tests they considered at that time. So through such an effort, they were able to produce a reliable rocket engine, not necessarily high performance. Well, this one shows the water flow test, cold flow test for the F1 engine. The mass flow rate is close to 6,000 pound mass per second, and I have to say that, okay, this is not an easy task at all, but we were able to accomplish that in 3 years' time. Well, of course, we paid a very, very high price in terms of money and manpower. This one shows the final product. What you're looking at is from the exit of the rocket engine toward the head end. This is the famous 5U pattern, and as I already mentioned, the mass flow rate is almost 6,000 pound mass per second. This is what happened at that time. Well, in a short summary, okay, the nation spent almost 3 years' time, and the entire project was divided into three different periods, starting with a PFRT, which stands for Preliminary Flight Rating Test, then all the way to the Flight Qualification Test. What about the full-scale engine testing? Well, a total of 1,332 engine tests were conducted, and with more than 1,000 component tests combined with 108 different injector patterns. So this is what they did at that time. Well, that's for space shuttle. 20 years later, the nation started the development of a space shuttle. Well, for space shuttle, the propulsion system is very much different. Essentially, okay, we use oxygen and hydrogen as propellants. And if you look at the propulsion system on the orbiter, so-called space shuttle, there are three different types of propulsion systems. We have a space shuttle main engine down here. Also, we have orbital maneuver engines. There are two at the exit of the orbiter. And also, they put a huge number of reaction control systems. This is for space shuttle. In addition to that, there are two mighty solid rocket boosters. Each solid rocket booster produces 1.5 million pound force. So this is what we did for space shuttle. And again, how much money we spend on that? Well, for space shuttle, the nation spent 2.45 billion in 1980s money, and that's about 7.7 billion in today's money. And again, can we afford? The answer is no, we cannot afford. Essentially, okay, this is a limiting factor for our entire space transportation and space exploration programs. Well, yeah. Another thing that I want to share with you is this. Even if we can afford that much money, say, close to 20 billion for the next generation oxygen and kerosene engines, how are we going to spend the money? Well, historically, okay, this is how we spend the money. Taking F1 engine as an example, there are more than 2,000 full engine tests, including the certification tests, and the number of reworks is about 203. Rework meaning, okay, redesign, troubleshooting, and retesting. That's the definition of a rework. For each rework, we have to spend $67 million in today's money. That's okay. That number is a very, very impressive. $67 million in today's money if we want to redesign and retest this rocket engine. For SSME, the situation is not much better. Rocketdyne spend 163 rework cycles, and for each rework cycle, they spend $37 million in today's money. So this is this business is essentially needs to be energized. Yes. Well, but looking to the future, what are we going to do? Well, we still need two different kinds of propulsion systems. We need a launch propulsion for low Earth orbit. And low Earth orbit essentially is for commercial and military space, although we still want to maintain our International Space Station there in order to facilitate our deep space exploration. In addition to that, we also need in-space propulsion. Well, for example, if we want to send people to a moon or even to the Mars, we need an in-space propulsion system. But for in-space propulsion system, the biggest problem we encounter nowadays is one, the payload is very limited. That's number one. And number two, the travel time is way too long. If you want to take a trip to Mars, as Elon Musk said, then a single trip may easily take you anywhere between 160 to 360 days. That's a one-way trip, depending on the relative location between Earth and Mars, all right? That's for one-way trip. But naturally, once you arrive there, you want to spend a few days there and also return. So it could easily spend almost 2 years' time for such a round trip, for this round trip to Mars. I don't know if we have the opportunity or privilege to go to Mars, but this is pretty much the situation. In other words, if you want to go there, you have to invest your personal time for at least 2 years, not including the training before the trip. So those are the practical issues that we have to address. But on the other hand, okay, for launch propulsion, I'm talking about near-Earth orbit. Well, the biggest problem is the cost. And it's very important for us to make access to space much more reliable, much more routine, and much more affordable. In terms of affordability, I think if we want to have a full commercialization of a space, we have to reduce our launch cost by a factor of 100. It's not by a factor of 10. Essentially, we have to reduce that cost by two orders of magnitude in order to have a full-scale commercial space. Otherwise, it's impossible. So now the much bigger issue is how to accomplish that. How to accomplish that? What is the best way for us to reduce the cost? By two orders of magnitude. By the way, yes, propulsion system always accounts for more than 50% of the entire launch cost. This is the rule of thumb. By propulsion systems, it's not just those rocket engines, but also tanks and associated control systems. It's 50%. So we have a need and a drive to substantially reduce our propulsion system development costs, and that's why we have to facilitate our design. Well, this is the way, how we want to spend money. How we want to spend money. Assuming we have enough resource to develop the next generation rocket propulsion system, then we have to spend initial design, that's a 2% engineering throughout the entire engine development program, all the way from initial design to certification. That percentage is 15%. Then on the top of that, we have to do our troubleshooting, redesign, testing. That's about a 75% cost. And then finally, demonstration and certification, that's a 10%. So in other words, we have to spend 75% of the entire budget on troubleshooting, redesign, and so forth. But on the other hand, okay, if our initial design is very close to the final design, then we can substantially reduce that part of the resource. So this part essentially is the game-changing part. We have to make sure that our initial design is very close to the final design in order to substantially reduce the cost. And then the next question we have to ask ourselves is, if the nation wants to develop the next generation's rocket engine, such as F1 engine that we developed 50 years ago, how much money that we can afford? Well, F1, if we want to redo F1, in the same way as we did 50 years ago, we have to spend almost $20 billion. That's a mission possible. But then the other side of the question is, how much money that we really can afford? Well, in my personal opinion, if we cannot develop the next generation rocket engine within $1 billion, my personal advice is don't do it. The reason, don't do it is, one, we are not ready to do it. That's number one. And number two is, we haven't got a chance to take advantage of recent advances in advanced design and related technologies. So that means, those are rocket engineers, they haven't got a chance to fully utilize recent design methodologies. For example, those are techniques established by Professor Martin and many others here. So $1 billion, if it's more than that, my advice is just don't do it. Now, the question is how to do it? Well, I'd like to share some of the things that we did in the past 2-3 years in this area. I like to use a case study to convey the concept. This case study is a Russian-made RD-170 engine. It's an oxygen-rich staged combustion cycle engine. This is the engine developed in Russia almost 30 years ago. A reduced version is called RD-170. RD-170 is the primary workhorse for US military rocket engine applications. So in other words, nowadays, more than 90% of our military launches use Russian-made engines. And that has become a series of political concerns, among many other concerns. Now, this engine has four thruster chambers, and it uses a staged combustion cycle, meaning they have a pre-burner, and also they have a main combustion chamber, all very high pressure. If you look at the main combustion chamber down here, the chamber operating pressure is more than 3,000 psi. And for the pre-burner, the chamber pressure is even higher, about 7,000 psi. So we are talking about very high pressure, very high density, most advanced rocket engines. This engine, in comparison with the F1 engine that we developed 60 years ago, is so much better in terms of performance. The ISP, the specific impulse, is 10% better than our F1 engine, and also it's much smaller because it operates at a very high pressure. Now, so I want to use this engine as a case study, and then we go from there. Well, now, the question is this. What is our design philosophy? As I said, one of the most important and difficult problems that we encountered in the 60s is the combustion stabilities, so-called unsteady pressure oscillations. And probably because of our bad experience with the F1 engine, the nation hasn't got a chance to develop a kerosene engine in the past 50 years. Because the combustion stability experience that we encountered 50 years ago still in our memory. That's why in the US, very few people would like to attack kerosene engines, especially at this size. So we want to start with a design philosophy. Let me have a quick description of this main combustion chamber. There are 331 injectors. 331 injectors. And this thruster chamber can produce almost a 500,000 pound thrust. And in the upstream, we have the so-called fuel manifold, and also we have a fuel distributor. We have a very high temperature, very high pressure, gaseous oxygen produced from the pre-burner, delivered into this manifold through the fuel distributor before entering the injectors. So this is the structure of this combustion chamber. If we look at those individual injectors, well, this is a 3D drawing, and the next one shows the details. We have a gaseous oxygen delivered into this injector, and also liquid kerosene is introduced into this injector tangentially, which will form a very strong swirling flow to facilitate the mixing and flame stabilization functions. So this is the injector design. Now, the question is this. That is the overall architecture in mind. Now we have to proceed with the specific design. The way to do it here is the following. Always start with the design, then at the same time, we should consider manufacturing, and also we should consider the best way to utilize the data. And everybody is the most familiar with this chart. Now the question is how to do it. If combustion instability is our biggest concern, then my personal suggestion is we should take the so-called defense in depth strategy. So in other words, we should provide design margins to the extent we can guarantee 100% success, even in the initial design stage. The question is how to do it? Well, we have a huge number of injectors, 331 injectors. What we want to make sure is each injector by itself can function well. It can burn 100% stable and also provide 100% performance. So that's why I call it the first line of defense is a stable combustion. Just in case line one fails, then what we want to do is we want to make sure those individual injectors can provide a sufficient damping because we have a flow passing through the injectors, and that will provide a viscous damping and also acoustic damping arising from vortex shedding and also the visco-acoustic interactions. So that's the second line of defense. If that defense is not sufficient, then we should do the third line of defense. Keep in mind, we have a flow distributor here. It's a very effective acoustic damper. And then the question is, what is the best way to design this flow distributor in terms of the number of orifices and also in terms of the configuration of the orifice and also in terms of the distribution of those orifices? So that's the third line of defense. Then if all fails, then probably we can use acoustic cavities such as Helmholtz resonators. And I have to say that, okay, well, for us, okay, this is very straightforward because we have to establish several lines of defense. But in practice, it's not so easy to do it. What is the design philosophy in the US in the past 60 years? Well, number one, we did not have the concept of a defense in depth concept. This is number one. And number two is the design philosophy is very interesting. In most of the cases, they just want to make sure those injectors can provide a stable combustion, but it's not 100% stable. People will say, let's just make sure it's a 90% stable. Then we can use acoustic cavity to provide the margin to ensure the system stability. I thought, okay, that's not a good practice. If you start with that kind of a philosophy, then naturally you would have to spend 75% of your entire budget on troubleshooting, because you started with a not so solid foundation. The design itself had way too many cracks, because your expectation is only 90% stable, and I thought it's a time for us to make a change. And so that's why in the future design, I would suggest that people consider this one, and then we use the other three lines to provide the design margin. This is the way to do it. Design margin is also very important, not just in terms of the the thermal fluid performance, such as combustion efficiency and so forth. It also provides the margin for manufacturing. If we have some problems with manufacturing, then through design, we can provide the margin and also at the same time to substantially reduce the cost. So that's the way to do it. Now, once we have that design philosophy in mind, then the next thing is we need a model. We need a model to characterize the overall system behavior. Well, the way to do it is the following. We thought, okay, one way to characterize the system behavior is a wave equation, because in terms of pressure. The reason is it's so easy for us to measure pressure compared with other parameters. This is number one. And then number two, pressure provides a direct physics in connection with this problem. Some people use a velocity potential. For example, okay, if you look at those PhD theses written at Princeton in the 60s, for example, Professor Luigi Crocco and his disciples at that time, they use a velocity potential. Mathematically, velocity potential is beautiful, but in physics, that requires a translation. That's number one. And the number two, we cannot measure velocity potential directly. So my suggestion is let's use pressure to describe the system dynamics, and as shown down here. But the problem is there are so many source terms, and also we should consider the mean flow effect. For example, the velocity distribution is non-uniform, the temperature distribution is non-uniform, let alone there are many gas dynamic and combustion source terms. So what we propose to do is let's put all the mean flow effect, gas dynamics, and the combustion source terms on the left-hand side. So this is the wave equation subject to appropriate boundary conditions. But on the other hand, okay, the boundary conditions are way too complicated. For example, we have to consider the geometric details. We have to consider 331 injectors here, combined with their external and internal geometries. And we should also consider the very detailed design of this flow distributor, and also this non-uniform shape of the combustor. So then the next thing is, how to solve this wave equation subject to this boundary conditions and subject to this very complex geometry. This is a practical issue. This is number one. Number two problem is there are so many source terms. What is the best way for us to describe those source terms? And that's another issue. So at a system level, well, once we have this in mind, then we go back to the fundamentals. Yes, this one shows the acoustic behavior of the entire combustion chamber. I probably can skip this. Yes. So what we did here is now we go back to the each components. So in other words, we start with a system level model. Then after that, we go back to the fundamental physics for those source terms at a component level. For a rocket engine, whether this is a rocket engine or a gas turbine engine, you always use injectors. So this is the injector. For the injector at this level, we use a high fidelity LES models, and in order to capture the very detailed dynamics. Well, this is a model problem. What we are looking at is a straight tube. Liquid propellant is injected tangentially in the upstream location. Then, as a consequence of centrifugal force, there is a swirling film attached to the wall of this injector, and also at the same time convected downstream. Geometrically, this is a very simple device, but the physics is extremely wealthy. If we go back to this fluid mechanics, it's so easy for us to identify seven different types of waves. For example, we have a shear layer. We have hydrodynamic instabilities within the liquid film. It's very similar to shallow water wave instability. And also we have Rayleigh-Taylor instabilities due to the density difference and also our Kelvin-Helmholtz instability due to the velocity difference, let alone we have acoustic waves propagating back and forth within this injector. So there are seven different types of instabilities. Now, the question is, what are you going to do with that? Well, fundamentally, okay, in terms of a design, it's very important for us to not just to extract the physics to fulfill our intellectual curiosity, but what's more important is, what is the best way for us to present the data in such a form that we can solve our wave equation? So the connection, okay, the connection really lies in the data presentation part. What to do that? This is the one issue. And another issue that we have to bear in mind is, well, this is a simple geometry, but in terms of a design, we have to consider design attributes, and what is the best way for us to survey the design space in such a timely fashion that we can proceed with our system level design. And well, this is what we did. Taking the injector used in the RD180 main combustion chamber as an example, there are 12 design attributes, so-called design parameters. Well, for example, the length of the injector, the diameter of the injector, the location of fuel injection, and so forth. So combined, there are 12 design parameters. Are they important? And I have to say that every single parameter is important. For example, if you want to solve instabilities in a full-size rocket engine, people found probably you can change the location of this LOX post a little bit by 1 millimeter. Then you can solve the problem. So we have to survey the design space. How to do it? Well, we have to use the so-called design of experiments to substantially reduce the number of cases that we want to do, and also at the same time to survey the design space. So that's what we did, yes. And for that particular case, okay, if we have a single swirler, we have 5 design parameters, then after DOE design of experiments, we are able to reduce the number of cases for high fidelity simulation down to 30 cases. Then once we develop those are 30 cases, we run LES, which provides the database. After that, we do emulation. We develop a surrogate model, so-called Kriging. But Kriging for this case is not very straightforward. What you're looking at here is, the upper part is the from LES calculation, and then the lower part is emulation. Is emulation from Kriging. This is a spatial temporal Kriging, and we use a common COD technique for this particular case to establish our emulation model. So for this case, for LES, each case took us several hundred thousand CPU hours to do the job, and then we run 30 cases concurrently to establish a huge database. Then after that, we develop this emulation model to help us survey the entire design space. And for emulation, the computational time is substantially less. It's on the order of a few hours, just a few hours on a desktop workstation. So this is the way for us to survey the design space. And then after that, this one shows different cases. I probably can skip this. After that, we move on to the combustion case because it's not just the flow, but also combustion case. What we are looking at here is the following. We have a gaseous oxygen delivered into this injector. Kerosene is injected tangentially from the sidewall, and then we notice that this part is so-called a shielded region. There are 3 cases. One is a shielded down here. The top case is without shielding. Then the bottom case is shielding all the way to the exit of this injector. So the purpose of this particular case is to study the effect of a shielding. From the engineering and the physics point of view, shielding is important because that will affect the flame stabilization process. One thing that I'd like to bring to your attention is when you look at a launch vehicle, it's a mighty device. For example, the Saturn V, a launch vehicle. And for a rocket engine, it's also big. For the combustion chamber, the real size for F1 engine is about this big. This is the combustion chamber. But don't underestimate this combustion chamber. Although it's not very big, but it's sufficiently to lift off. Taking F1 as an example, it's sufficient to lift off six Boeing 747 aircraft. So it's a very, very high energy density device. But everything starts from here. And what is the thickness of this LOX post? For many cases, it's less than 1 millimeter. So in other words, when you design such a high power rocket engine, you got to pay attention to a spatial domain, which is less than 1 millimeter. If you failed to anchor your flame within such a special domain, then the chance for you to get a stable rocket engine is a practical zero. So that's why, okay, we always use a very detailed, a very high fidelity LES to get the whole picture. Then we run that for a small number of cases. Using that as a database, then we do the emulation. Then using emulation, we survey the entire design space. And that's our approach. I think this is the exciting part, especially in the US. Yes, well, we noticed that, yes, a flame is anchored in that very tiny spatial domain. As I said, it's less than 1 millimeter. Then you see the flame evolution and also the impact on the wall, and that's very important in terms of heat transfer and so forth. This is what we have. Well, this is important in several aspects. Number one is, this is the very first time we are able to look into the flame within such a practical situation. This is number one. And the number two is, okay, although in terms of a rocket engine in the US, we already lag behind the Russian by at least 30 years, at least 30 or even 40 years for this particular case. But on the other hand, okay, we think, okay, our understanding is better than Russian these days, and because of those kind of advanced diagnostics and high fidelity simulations, because we found, okay, the way Russian explain the flame stabilization is very much different from what we understand nowadays, because they thought that the flame is anchored in this recirculation zone. And we think the flame is anchored in the wake region of the dark post. And that's something very, very encouraging. This is what we have for this case, and then I probably can skip this. And this one shows a more detailed flow evolution. And again, pay attention to this tiny space. What are the research issues? Well, the research issues that we encountered here are pretty much the same as those encountered for reacting flow simulations. And we are still working on more reliable SGS models, small scale modeling, that's one. We are still working on high pressure kinetics, high pressure, low temperature kinetics, because the temperature here is very low, and we continue to improve the spatial resolution of the flame. But that's a research ongoing. It's a separate from what we discussed here in terms of a design. Yes. Well, then okay. This is one, and another thing is okay. Well, through this process, and again, we do emulation for the reacting flow cases in order to assess the effect of each design parameter. For this particular case shown down here, we want to have a good understanding of the effect of this recess distance. And as I said before, this design parameter or this design attribute plays a very, very important role. Oftentimes, you can change the length of that recess region, this region, by 1 millimeter, then you can make your rocket engine from stable to unstable. And again, without a high fidelity modeling technique, the chance for us to accomplish that is a practical zero. But on the other hand, okay, without advanced design methodology for us to survey the entire design space is also mission impossible. This is something. Well, that's okay for our gaseous and liquid propulsion system. What about liquid-liquid system? Liquid-liquid system is also very important, even for the next generation rocket engines, whether it's a Blue Origin's B4, Aerojet Rocketdyne's AR1, or SpaceX's Raptor engine, the pre-burner always use a liquid-liquid system, operating at a very, very high pressure. This is one example showing the situation for a liquid-liquid system. Essentially, we have liquid oxygen injected tangentially into the center tube. Then we have a liquid kerosene injected in the outer area. Then here we see the flame stabilization and the flame spreading process. This is what we have here, yes. And then, okay, what about the acoustics? Well, we do exactly the same thing for acoustics. For acoustics, so there are several important aspects. For example, the internal damping within each injector, that's one. And also, when we look at the surface down here, it's not a flat surface. It's a ridged surface with a very irregular shape. So acoustic scattering effect ought to be considered. In the top, we have this flow distributor. Well, this flow distributor plays a very important role because, okay, when flow passes through those orifices, that will produce vortices. And a vortex is a wonderful acoustic damping mechanism because energy can be transferred from acoustic waves to the mean flow, then convected by those vortices. That's one. And another one is a direct viscous damping. This is very important. For this particular case, people use more than 600 orifices to damp out acoustic cavities. To damp out acoustic oscillations. And I have to say that, yes, this is a very, very important in terms of a design methodology. If you look at some of the rocket engine currently under development in the US, they did not use this flow distributor. The reason they did not use this flow distributor are, one, lack of knowledge, and two, not humble enough. I'm sorry to say this, yes, because we must be very humble in order to move forward. And so for various reasons, they did not use that. And I thought this is something people really want to pay attention to this matter, yes. And then what about the design space? Well, the design space is a flow distributor configuration and also the chamber configuration. Is this the best design? We're not quite sure. And in terms of a performance, in terms of a heat transfer, and also in terms of a manufacturing. So that's another variable we have to consider. And the third one probably is the most important thing is injector design, injector geometry, and injector layouts, and then so forth. And as I said, for each injector, there are 12 design parameters that we have to cope, we have to be concerned. And another thing which is, I think this is the heart of the entire problem, is let's go back to this diagram. Yes. We have a rigorous combustion showing down here. And a combustion can always interact with unsteady motions and to generate acoustic excitations. So the question is, what is the best way for us to characterize the unsteady heat release behavior? And that part of the job is not easy. Frankly speaking, this is something people try to attack in the past 70 years, starting with Professor Luigi Crocco's work in the late 40s and early 50s. If you go back to the literature, you notice that there's a very famous monograph published in 1952 by Professor Luigi Crocco and S.I. Chen at that time. But they use a very simple model. Essentially, they use two models to describe the entire combustion response. It's time for us to move forward for several reasons. Number one, combustion is a distributed behavior. It happened in three dimensions throughout the entire combustion chamber. That's number one. And then number two, okay, it depends on the spatial location. It also depends on the frequency content. So the real issue is, what is the best way to extract the combustion response function from our high-fidelity simulation, and also at the same time, to present the data in such a form, which can be used in the system-level model, which essentially is the wave model. In that regard, okay, there are two different ways for us to do it. Number one is, okay, once we have this huge data, let's try to establish correlations between unsteady heat release with the flow variables. That's one way to do it. But oftentimes, we may not be able to establish such a well-defined correlations because the physics are so complex. So if that's not the case, then we have to use the data-based correlation. So in other words, once we have surveyed the entire design space, then we do data correlation directly from whatever database we have. Then after that, we plug into our system level model, then we close the loop. So that's the way that we are doing right now. It's not an easy job, but it's something that we have to do that. What about experimental validation? Well, we talk about so many things about design and different modern techniques. We use a single element injector rig. Yes, that's one. I probably can skip that. And also, what about the situation with multiple injectors in a practical rocket engine environment? Well, in that regard, okay, we have to consider several things. For example, the packaging, the spacing between injectors, and that's another important design parameters. In that regard, okay, we are working on several things. For example, we do high fidelity simulation, but this time it's not just for single element injector. We consider a cluster of injectors by controlling the spacing and also at the same time to study the injector-injector interactions. That's what we are doing right now. And then once we finished everything, don't forget, we should go back to the base. And the base here is the system level model, which is described by this inhomogeneous wave equation, subject to all the geometric details. And with that, we probably can have a much better design. Where do we stand? High fidelity model, LES, is an ongoing research program, probably for the next many years, and that's ongoing. On the design part, a creaking part, emulation is also a work in progress because each database is so big. One thing that I like to bring to your attention is big data has become a big thing for the entire community, but engineering design will give big data a different meaning. The reason is taking this combustion chamber design as an example, we cannot handle too many cases. We can, unlike so-called big data, don't have too many cases. For single element injector, we only consider 30 cases, but each case give us a big database because it's a three-dimensional spatial temporal evolving flows. So that's a fundamental difference, unlike big data in the sense of B2B or internet business, that kind of a big data. So we have a limited number of cases, but each case has a huge database, and that is also an ongoing research. With that, okay, I probably should stop here, and we'll be very happy to answer any questions that you have. Thank you so much.
Thank you.